Hello, and a very warm welcome to all of you. I'm Dimitris, and I'm the Chief Operating Officer at Signal. Thank you all for gracing us with your presence tonight. They say absence makes the heart grow fonder. And certainly, this is a shared feeling across Posidonia this year. Amongst you, we see friends we've missed and partners we value. And we're certainly super eager to catch up and see what has been going on. Over these crazy times, shipping has continued day in, day out to connect a world that has been disrupted. With its unrivaled adaptability, shipping has stored oil when demand and prices plummeted, has transported the world's commodities and finished goods to battle COVID, both physically and mentally, and has prepared to battle climate change. Through adversity and challenge, almost all shipping markets saw ups and downs. And with the ups returned some smiles and some excitement about our otherwise oversupplied freight markets. And in reference to our theme for tonight, we are all experiencing the onset of a new era of technology adoption across our domain, possibly accelerated by all these factors. So, over the next 55 minutes or so, we're going to call upon our esteemed keynote speaker to inspire us with ideas from the cutting edge of technology, while also perhaps seeding our thinking as to how shipping could benefit. Our group CEO, Yannis, will share elements of our technology vision by speaking about some of the things that we are hard at work on. Panos, our CEO on the shipping side, we'll tell the story of how Signal Maritime approaches commercial pooling. And Nicolas from Signal Ventures will bring us short and salient investment perspectives from a truly vibrant maritime tech scene. All this, hopefully, as thought-provoking passage to the main aim of tonight, which is, of course, to enjoy each other's company over nice food and drink and exchange views. So, to get started, please allow me to call to the stage our group CEO, Yannis Martinos, who will set the scene and introduce our keynote speaker. Yanni.
Hello, everyone. It's great to see so many of you here. I'm delighted to see how Posidonia this year is a celebration of all the markets doing really well, and a celebration of Greek shipping, which is obviously the number one superpower in the world, and that makes me very proud. So, when we started the Signal Ocean platform, we started with a 20-year vision. And when you think about things 20 years forward, it's actually quite daunting to try to guess what's going to happen in the future. When I was growing up, I would hear stories about people making predictions for the next 20 years or 30 years, and they were quite inspiring. Some of them, coming from very respected technologists, they were a bit ambitious. So as a first example, I have something that we all have heard at some point in our lives, that we're going to have flying cars. So growing up in the 80s, you would hear that by the year 2000, we might have flying cars. Instead of flying cars, we now have Teslas. Teslas are amazing cars. I'd love to have one myself, but it's not flying yet. So this prediction, I would say, has obviously not turned out to be right. The second prediction that if you were interested in computer, you would hear about when you were young, is that computers are going to miniaturize to the point where you're going to be able to fit one in your pocket. So the time has gone by. We all have these amazing devices in our pockets, which are more powerful than computers that used to fill up a room 30 or 40 years ago. So this prediction, which is also associated with Moore's law, is clearly correct, and we have all been affected by this change. In fact, the key car of the Tesla has more computing power than the lunar lander that landed on the moon in 1969. And I find that fascinating. So scientists do get things right sometimes when they make long-term predictions, and that's a very strong example. And finally, an example that is related to shipping in some way is that when eBay came to the scene in the mid-90s and became one of the first very successful companies in the internet era, when the World Wide Web was invented, there were a lot of people that were in the fine art business that were getting alarmed, thinking that maybe one day eBay will be selling Picassos. And eBay has done very well. It's been a very successful company, but it has stopped more, let's say, at the level of comic books or maybe some more valuable artifacts, but never reached the Picasso level. And funnily enough, I was in New York a month ago, and I had lunch with the president of Christie's, which is one of the two big auction houses. And he said to me, or I asked him first, I said, you know, what do you think about eBay? He said, yes, we used to worry about eBay a lot 20 years ago, but we're not worried about eBay anymore. And I say, why not? And he looked at me and said, personal relationships. And he laughed. And I made immediately the connection with shipping and knew at that point that I was going to use this example in my presentation today, because it's related to another very hot topic that I will talk about in the next slide. So when we were preparing the presentation, we said, okay, let's try to make some prediction about what will change in shipping. And it's pretty difficult to make such predictions. There are so many failed examples in the past, and I didn't feel that risky. So I said, you know, the first step that we need to do is say, not how shipping necessarily will change, but let's make sure we get right what will not change about shipping. And the first and obvious, you know, part of our business, and one which we consider to be a key factor when conducting successfully business in shipping, is personal relationships. And that's the connection with the Christie's example. So it's an obvious example, but I consider it a given. A second example, which is maybe not as clear to everyone, is that private and confidential information is here to stay. There are people, especially in the technology world, that are democratizing some of the information, but I don't think that is a trend that can actually come to full completion, because many of the commodity traders would rather keep the price at which they're selling their commodities and the destination of where their commodities are going secret. Finally, in my opinion, brokers will remain essential in the world of shipping. Anytime someone talks about technology, one of the first questions that comes up is what happens to brokers. And in part because of the two above reasons, the personal relationships and the private and confidential information, but also for other reasons like the complexity of the trade, brokers will remain essential in my opinion. Also, one noticeable thing since last Posidonia is I feel that the broking community is a little bit less scared of technology as well, which is an indication that this prediction or non-prediction will turn out to be right. So if these are the things that some of the things that are not going to change, what will change? Well, one or the first one, which is the obvious one, it has already started to change. We have a lot of pressure from society and governments to have, you know, and we have to have better ESG standards as an industry. There's more security and more scrutiny, more scrutiny and more expectations from us as an industry. We only emit 3% of the global CO2, but that doesn't mean that we do not have to do our part and take that 3%. To neutral zero emissions in the years to come. The second one that might be a bit less obvious is that you can see that the quality of commercial and technical management out there is improving continuously, and there are more companies to which a ship owner can outsource part of the, let's say, operation that they have. And we think that there's going to be an increased number of ship owners that will choose to take such, such an approach to doing business. And this will also lead to some commercial consolidation, which is something that hasn't happened before. And it will be too interesting to see what will happen if fewer companies concentrate more commercial control of tonnage in their hands. And finally, the obvious change that we are all experiencing at many levels, let's say, in our lives, is that things are becoming faster more generally. But specifically in shipping, I think you're going to see a 10 times speed execution speed improvement in the way we fix ships. This has already happened once. You know, if you look back 30 years ago, we're fixing a lot faster now. But also, it will be how fast you order bunkers, it will be how fast you order provisions, it will be how fast you do the analysis of your main engine, and all the things that take a lot of time now. At least half of them are going to become 10 times faster over the next 20 or 30 years, in my opinion. So not necessarily any flying car predictions on my side, maybe a little bit more modest ones. So it's going to be more like Teslas instead of flying cars, and more like traditional auction house dynamics instead of eBay. And now it's a great pleasure to introduce our main and the keynote speaker, Konstantinos Daskalakis, who we're lucky to call an advisor at Signal, among other things. Konstantinos is a professor at MIT, and there are a few legends about how great of a student he was when he was at Politecnio, where he almost got the perfect 10, which is unheard of. His PhD thesis in the University of Berkeley got awarded as the best PhD thesis from all computer science theses that year in all universities. And also, that immediately opened up a series of professorship positions in all the great schools in the States and around the world. And Konstantinos chose to become a professor at MIT. And since he did that, he kept amassing more and more awards. The latest one that is really important is the Nevanlinna Award, which is awarded once every 4 years to one computer scientist in the entire world. So if you think of that, it's a little bit like getting, you know, a gold medal in the Olympics at 100 meters dash. So he's like the Usain Bolt of computer science and game theory. So Konstantinos will share with us a presentation which is more broadly exploring what computer science can do. And hopefully this will be an inspiration for all of us to potentially use some of these ideas to improve our domain of shipping. Konstantin, thank you.
Hi, everybody. Thanks a lot for the invitation to be here. Also, thanks to all of you for being here. So I believe in the transformative power of computing. And being an advisor at Signal, it's been great to see the progress that is happening in that space. I hope it will transform your business as well. This is also the topic of today's presentation. And what I want to do is I want to take you through a journey, through the developments in the field of computing. Starting since the early days, when a young Alan Turing published his paper on computable numbers. and connect it out to developments in mathematical logic within the field of mathematics. Of course, you probably know Alan Turing as Benedict Cumberbatch in this movie. So the importance in this paper was that Alan Turing proposed a way to think of computation through a mathematical lens. And this was fundamental because it took computers from the specialized kind that there were before, like the antique ether mechanism or the looms, the nomadic looms, to general purpose computers. Turing is not... Is that better? Yeah. Turing is not single-handedly the father of the modern computer. Earlier work by Babbage and Ada Lovelace also contributed to those developments. Interesting for us Greeks is that Ada Lovelace was actually the daughter, the abandoned daughter of Lord Byron. So while Lord Byron was here fighting for the Greek independence and inspiring through his poems the world to support the War of Independence, Ada was back in England working in translating Babbage's work from Etokiev in Italy, and which was later translated into French, back into English, and was one of the first programmers of general purpose computers. In any event, so modern computers give us a lot of good things and a lot of bad things. And that trajectory continued to the modern era, where computer science is not just about computation, but it's affecting virtually every aspect of our lives. Here are some familiar applications of computer science in modern world. And these applications have been transformative, as you know, I hope you agree, okay? Sometimes for the better and sometimes for the worse. Traditionally, computation is about trade-offs, thinking about how to bring about an important computation and achieve a good trade-off between resources. The main ones being the time it takes to do some computation and the storage you need to use to do that computation, but also other aspects are important, such as how elegant is your algorithm and do you use randomness in your computation, or do you use other types of resources like quantum entanglement, okay, as you see on the right. So these are the fundamental trade-offs, but what's important also is where this computation takes place. Does it take place in a data center, or is it distributed across a global network, or is it happening on a social network, or a market, or a blockchain, or some biological system inside the brain? Is it used to understand the microcosm or geometric properties of, you know, folded paper and so on and so forth? Or is it used in applications of the sharing economy, such as Airbnb, eBay, etc.? What's also important is what the computation does and what type of access it has to its input, right? So sometimes the input is encrypted or redacted, or it's strategic, trying to compete against another player, or it's computation that takes place in a physical brain or a digital brain, or is the input stochastic, or is it adversarial? Okay, so classically in computer science, when we talk about adversaries who are crazy, we think of them as Byzantine generals. So in any event, so computation has various flavors, And those depend on where it takes place, what type of access it has to its input, what does it do to its input, and you know, how and what computational resources it uses. And I want to give you some examples of that, some familiar and some less familiar ones. So the classical use of computation is to do optimization. One of the earliest uses of optimization was for defense or attack applications. So here's the map of the USSR railroad connecting West Russia to East Europe. This is from a classified report of the US Air Force that became public in the late 90s. And what you see here is you know, various connections, railroad connections, how much capacity they have. And if you squint your eyes, you can see sort of like two lines that cut across the network. And this was a computation that the Air Force did, thinking about what is the most efficient way to bombard this network to cut the connection between Russia and Europe. So that's one instance of optimization. Of course, there are a lot of other instances, but this is an interesting one. Computation takes place in biology and medicine, and there the purpose is different. The purpose is to mine information that comes in a very raw form, right? So the genome is millions of base pairs. And those base pairs encode important biological information, but we just don't understand it. So over there, algorithms are used to mine useful and actionable information from the genome for the purpose of understanding the evolutionary history of species, do personalized medicine, or drug design. That's another type of information. Here we try to mine info out of the out of genomic or other omic data. Third example is in crypto, right? So here we don't, so we try to do a bunch of things. So, you know, one type of thing we want to do is we have some message in the clear and we want to encode it so that we send it over a channel and it cannot be understood by an eavesdropper. Or we try to do the opposite, right? I mean, if you saw that movie, you remember that Alan Turing was involved in Second World War attempts to break the Enigma code that was used by the German army. In fact, again, interesting for us Greeks, and certainly definitely me, I'm from Crete, one of the first uses of the breaking of the Enigma code was for the Battle of Crete. It gave a lot of advantage to the Allied forces. We use cryptography to for electronic signatures, and more recently for it's in the backbone of blockchain, and so on and so forth. Cryptography is very important for internet purchases. It's all over the place. That's another type of computation, right? I mean, so far we have optimization, where we have the input and we want to do some interesting, want to find an interesting solution for a problem. In biology, where we have the input, but it's in such raw form that we don't understand what it says and we want to mine information out of it. So in crypto, we have messages we want to encrypt, someone else has encrypted messages, we want to break it, or we want to prove that we actually wrote a message that somebody might claim we wrote. Or we use it for building the backbone of this blockchain revolution that is ongoing. Third example is in economics and game theory, right? I mean, one of the most transformative applications of computing in recent decades is in market design. And there we have computational systems that are also markets. So we have to understand how economics and computation come together. And this may be to understand how strategic agents behave in these environments. So may want to understand, you know, like, you know, what happens in games like soccer or like or chess, you know, how to optimize strategies in markets or transportation networks, or like how to design elections, or how to split rooms in a house with our roommates. In all these examples, we want to use computation to understand how strategic individuals might behave when they're boundedly rational. And this is a departure from classical economics, which, you know, for a big part, assumes that humans are, you know, perfectly rational and can do unboundedly complex computations in their minds to decide how to act. In reality, our brains are computationally bounded, so we cannot have a theory of strategic interactions that doesn't take that important aspect into account. And indeed, this was the main topic of my PhD thesis back when I was in Berkeley, trying to think about the foundations of game theory and economics using a computational approach, challenging theories like the Nash equilibrium that lied in the foundations of economics. I've already talked about that. Market design is one of the most important recent contributions of computer science to the world. You know, you all know that, you know, the backbone of the internet economy is auctions happening in banner ads and in sponsor shirts. But markets are in other places too, right? I mean, online dating is a market. You know, people come together, they express their preferences, and an algorithm matches them. You know, the sharing economy is a market. So you have, you know, drivers and riders all coming together, matched up in an efficient manner. Lots of examples of those, and then the goal is, you know, like how do you build a market that is computationally and economically efficient at the same time? I mean, you don't want to wait forever for Uber to decide, who the match you with, and you know, you also don't want to wait for like 15 minutes for the Uber to come to your house, right? So, this is a big market, and matches must happen, very efficiently. So, you need to marry computation and incentives and economic considerations together. So, I want to talk about a different type of market, and this is an important market. In fact, a few years ago, maybe 10 years ago, a Nobel Prize in Economics was awarded for this type of work. To Al Roth. So, as you might know, it's hard to find a family member who wants to donate a kidney for you that, that matches, what the type of kidney that you need. So typically, this happens in pairs. So like you see on the right. So this is a pair, but it's incompatible. The mother wants to donate a kidney to the son, but they're incompatible. And over here, a husband wants to donate a kidney to a wife, but they're also incompatible. But the across donations are compatible. So you want to find such pairs that are compatible if you match, the donor of one with a receiver of the other, and vice versa. But this is very rare as well. Right, I mean, you have to find these pairs. You need to satisfy two constraints, right? I mean, you want to find two pairs, and you have one constraint and another constraint. If only one constraint is present, is satisfied, you cannot match. You know, this pair is not compatible. And this is where market design is important, because you can do something else. You can make an algorithm aware of all the pairs of a receiver and of a donor and a receiver that there are, and you can do more complex matches, like matching them in long cycles or chains, like this one, right? So over here you have three pairs, and the donor of that is compatible with the receiver of this one, the donor of that one is compatible with the receiver of that one, and the donor of this one with the receiver of this one. So you can build cycles, right? And you can improve the efficiency of the matches that you can accomplish with a given set of pairs of donors and receivers that you have. And of course, you have to also, it's not just, what's important here is not just the computation, but also the incentive aspect, right? So you don't want hospitals to withhold easy cases and only make the algorithm aware of the hard cases that they cannot match internally. You want to provide incentives. You want a design that incentivizes hospitals to upload everything that they have to the market, to the algorithm, so that a more efficient match is accomplished. So here's an example of a very efficient match. So this is a volunteer donor who says, okay, I have a kidney, I'm willing to donate it. But that donor basically gave rise to this chain of, I don't know, like about 20 I think about, I don't know, 10 or 15 or something patients receiving a kidney. So this is very, very important. I guess I'm giving a talk at a shipping event, so I'm like, I wanted to say something about shipping, so I'm going to say two things about shipping. So one is in the next slide, and one is in the very last slide. Related to the kidney application, I guess, one may ask, okay, like, so Jan has mentioned that, so, so shipping emits CO2, and sometimes travel times are longer than they should be. And you may ask, okay, like, is there a way to get more efficient matches? Well, here's, one example where, if you were to rearrange the match of the vessel and the cargo, you could actually improve, the travel times and the CO2s. So what's happening here? You have a vessel available there, and you have a vessel available there. Now this one travels over here to pick up cargo to bring it there. Well, you could have this guy pick it up and take it there, and instead have that guy pick it up from, I don't know, here and take it up there. Okay, so I guess they have the same destination. This is an example of something that is feasible. You could imagine, multi-way reshufflings of, matches of, vessels and cargoes and things like that, trying to improve, consumption, emission, and travel times, or do post hoc analysis of how inefficient shipping trade is once you have that information of what trades happened in the last month, let's say. But the point is, okay, this is theoretical. The question is, how can a more efficient market be facilitated so that these goals of improving those things are actually accomplished? So this is my little stylistic example of shipping. Obviously, I don't know what I'm talking about, so let's keep going. The last thing I want to talk about is an ongoing revolution, and this is in the this is an information revolution around artificial intelligence and its supporting fields of machine learning, statistics, and data science. So I guess, as probably you all know, AI has had some breakthroughs in the past decade, and here are some examples. Some of these technologies are already out there in our phones, okay, or our Amazon Alexas or Siris and so on and so forth. So image recognition and voice recognition are problems that have seen dramatic progress in the past decade. There are more. Translation has made amazing progress. Playing difficult games like Go, you probably all have heard that the DeepMind algorithm, AlphaGo, can beat human players in this very difficult game. And more recently, in protein folding, which is a difficult computational problem, as well as something that I'm going to talk about in more depth, and this is the rage right now, okay, which is in text generation and language models. All right, so what is language models? Language models are AIs whose goal is simple. You give them some text, their goal is to predict the next word. You're familiar with it. So this is from my phone. I was talking to somebody, okay, so they said, no worries, walking there, you know, and I had some suggestions, right? Okay, here, thanks. Where did this come from? Well, from such a model, right? So the model was given as input all this information, all this text, and was asked, what is a likely word that may follow this conversation, okay? And this model was trained on data of people talking to each other on their cell phones and so on and so forth. And it thought that these are likely words that may come after this conversation. All right? And, you know, in this case, these were reasonable suggestions. As you see, I didn't use any, but in any event. Now, these language models can be trained on, you know, like a bunch of people's text conversations, but on steroids, you can train these models on all textual information that is out there in the world. Okay, so you can train such models on, you know, like, you know, the Library of Congress, you know, the whole Wikipedia, you know, all the web, all text that you can find. All right, and this becomes pretty amazing if you do that. So here's how you can use them to do amazing stuff. All right, so again, this model is built to predict the next word if you give it some text. So here's one example. So I give it this text, correct this to standard English, she no went to the market. This model by OpenAI called GPT-3 thinks that what should come after this text is she didn't go to the market. It's pretty impressive, right? I mean, this thing was never, like, this model was not taught to correct bad English to good English. This model was trained on the whole of web for the, you know, with the sole goal of doing a good job at predicting what is a reasonable word to follow a given piece of text. So when you give it this piece of text, it says, okay, I think a reasonable word to follow is she, then didn't, then go, then to the market, okay? So this is what the model thinks, and it's correct, okay? It's pretty impressive. Here's some other examples. Here's a prompt, you give this model, and what it does. Translate this into 1, French, 2, Spanish, and 3, Japanese. What rooms do you have available? 1, okay? This is what you give it. And here's what it thinks should follow after 1. Quelles sont les chambres disponibles? 2. Okay, I don't know any Spanish. Quelles sont les habitaciones disponibles? And 3. Okay, something that I definitely cannot read, okay? But what's the point here? So, like, it's pretty amazing if you think about it. Like, again, this was not trained to do any translation, right? So this was trained on the whole of web, the whole of Library of Congress, for again, the sole purpose of predicting the next word. And, you know, after it reads this text and sees a 1, it predicts that the next word should be quel, the word after that should be son, etc. Okay, pretty impressive, like scary impressive. Another example, okay, so this is, okay, like in a different domain. You give it some Python piece of code, and you put a comment inside the code, and you say explanation of what the code does, another comment symbol, and then it actually explains the code that it saw. Again, pretty impressive. And, okay, I guess this is my last example. Here's another thing you can do. You can say, okay, like, convert, so the prompt here is this, convert movie titles into emoji. Back to the Future, boom, boom, boom. Batman, boom, boom. Transformers, this and that, right? Star Wars, column. Okay, so it decides that, you know, a good sequence of emojis for Star Wars is this 2 you see there. Pretty cool, actually. Right, again, it was not trained to do this, okay? So it just, learned very well, right? Like, what should come after a given piece of code? All right, so this is GPT-3 by OpenAI. Now, the newest rage in this front is that you can combine these language models with image generation models, and you can do this kind of stuff. You can build algorithms that are given a prompt and generate an image. Okay, so this is called DALL-E 2. There was a DALL-E, this is DALL-E 2, second version. It uses GPT-3 inside it, a language model, and here's what it can do. Okay, here are some examples that I have here. All right, sorry. Prompt: painting of a family of tiny hippos inside of an old-fashioned vintage suitcase. Boom, it generates this image. This is pretty good, right? I mean, it's amazing what it does. So it saw this text, and it decided that a good painting accompanying this text would be this painting. It generated, this painting is not anywhere on the web. It painted it, okay? And it painted it with this direction. So here's another example. A still of Kermit the Frog in a Wes Anderson film. And it says, okay, here's a still. Of course, you know, I don't think that Kermit the Frog appears in any Wes Anderson film, okay? So, but, you know, the model learned how Wes Anderson films look like and how to render Kermit the Frog inside such a movie. And, you know, in case you wonder, a still of Kermit the Frog in Blade Runner, a still of Kermit the Frog in Wall-E, and so on and so forth, okay? So, you know, there. All right, so this is DALL-E 2, combining this amazing language models with models that can generate new pictures. Last example, here's the textual prompt, an astronaut riding a horse in a photorealistic style generates this image. In the style of Andy Warhol, generates that image. As a pencil drawing, generates that image. Everything, all of this is automatic, no human intervention, okay? So these models know how to think about text, they know how to think about paintings and photos, and what is reasonable painting, and you know, they know enough about the world that they recognize, you know, they produce this as an Andy Warhol painting, and they produce this as a photorealistic one, and that one as a drawing. It's pretty, it's scary impressive. I guess, you know, like, I mean, yeah, these are breakthroughs. And, you know, one way to show somebody that, you know, some breakthroughs have happened is to show some examples of what those breakthroughs can do, as I hope I accomplished. So I'm a mathematician at heart, you know, these are cool examples, but, you know, reality is not as impressive as you might think. So, you know, Yanis may want to get a Tesla, but here's a Tesla crashing into a truck that is, you know, stopped on the left lane of a highway. Maybe Teslas didn't know that trucks sometimes can actually, you know, for whatever reason, stop on the left of the highway, and this was not probable in its mind, so it just went straight to it. These are some interesting examples of how this amazing language model I was talking about before, you know, like correcting English and, you know, translating and this and that, can fail. Here's an example of a prompt. So the prompt is with boldface. You're having a small dinner party. You want to serve dinner in the living room. The dining room table is wider than the doorway. So to get it into the living room, you will have to, and then, you know, let it predict the next word and the word after that and so on and so forth. So here's the prediction. So you have to remove the door. You have a table saw. So you cut the door in half and remove the top half. So in its mind, this was a probable continuation of this prompt. But of course, I mean, yeah, this sounds kind of reasonable maybe, but probably not what we would do, right? So it's not, it definitely didn't gain intuition about how the, you know, you should do in this kind of situation. Okay, so here's another example. Let me not go through all of them. Biological reasoning. Okay, so again, the prompt is in bold and boldface. You pour yourself a glass of cranberry juice, but then you absentmindedly poured about a teaspoon of grape juice into it. It looks okay. You try sniffing it, but you have a bad cold, so you can't smell anything. You're very thirsty, so you drink it. You're now dead. Right, so not real understanding of the world. It's a kind of like sort of understanding of the world, unpredictable quality, right? It's not the type of thing that you would like to have in like production code without human supervision. It can definitely be super useful. Like, I mean, like producing all those images that I was showing you, right? I mean, pretty amazing for artists, but some human supervision is good to have in this kind of scenario. Okay, so talking about images, prompt, oil painting of old Elon Musk tweeting about 420. Maybe one is a reasonable image, but this one is definitely not a reasonable image. Nevertheless, it's pretty good. I mean, yeah, it's pretty good. Like, if I was an artist, maybe I would publish that picture rather than this picture. Incidentally, I don't know if you're familiar with what 420 is, but look it up later. It has to do with okay. It has to do with something. Okay. Now, a bigger problem is that these AIs can be manipulated. Here's a manipulation by a bunch of students at MIT. Of a image recognition algorithm. As I was saying, image recognition is already in production. It's in our phones. You can try your camera, the camera in your phone, and it can recognize things. I mean, if you ask it to, you can input images into Google Image Search and figure out, what is the flower that you saw on the street, like if you don't know what it is, and so on and so forth. But you can also manipulate these algorithms, and this can pose serious threats. So in this video, what these guys did is they 3D printed a little turtle, and they painted the shell of the turtle in such a way that the best image recognition algorithm recognizes it as a rifle rather than a turtle, which is fine. Except, you wouldn't want the opposite if this algorithm is used in the airport for security. These are similar attacks. So, these algorithms are very sensitive, have sensitivity with the data that they're used to be trained. So, many times if things change between the training set and the test set, their behavior is might be unpredictable. So here you see the results of a image recognition algorithm when you show it things to recognize, but in the right orientation. So this is recognized as a revolver, and this is recognized as a vulture. However, if you rotate things a little bit, all bets are off. So if you rotate the image a little bit, this is now a mouse trap according to this algorithm. And this is an orangutan. Okay, so these are sensitive things, and it's hard to prove how they would do in an unpredictable setting. Last example of failure. Algorithms are amazing in painting images, in understanding images, in understanding the mathematical, properties, encompassing what are natural and photorealistic images or paintings or this and that, but they have biases because they're trained on data that you collected and trained them on. So here's an example of a blurry image of Obama. I mean, I hope you can all humans in the room can see that this is Obama. Yeah. But if you ask an algorithm to improve the resolution of this image, it thinks that a reasonable guess for who is behind this image is that guy, which, I mean, it's reasonable, but it is biased, right? I mean, it's biased towards white Caucasian people. Why? Because the training data that it was used to, that we're used to train it on, mostly comprised of white people. And you know, like that's just an example, but like image recognition software is used in the law enforcement in the States and other places, and to produce scores about whether you should or not pre-detain somebody who was arrested for some crime. And those algorithms are really biased against, you know, non-whites. Okay, breakthroughs, yes, but there is a lot of unreliability. And at this point, you have to be careful when you use these technologies. I mean, they can definitely be used, but not in a setting where the conditions under which they might be used are a bit unpredictable. So we need to improve their reliability. And what matters a lot about whether or not some AI that was trained on some data is reliable are the following factors. The sample size that you had to train them on. Big sample sizes, a lot of observations are always better. But your observations should be representative of the conditions under which you're going to use your model. If you collect data, say, from Greece, and you want to use your model in the US, then all bets are off, because your samples are not representative of the conditions that your system will find itself in the future. What's super important, and this explains why there hasn't been a breakthrough use of this technology in life sciences, is the dimensionality of the data. So data, like genomic data, is the sample sizes are small. I mean, even like, you know, like if you have sample sizes in the, which is amazing, in the UK Biobank and other databases, like 500,000 is amazing size, but compared to the dimensionality of the genome, which is millions of base pairs, is nothing. This is a real challenge. And explains a lot why we haven't seen, you know, this ML breakthroughs being used in, you know, in life sciences. You know, the presence or not of adversaries. Like, is there going to be somebody who will try to manipulate my, you know, image recognition software used in my airport or not? Okay, so that's an important consideration. If there might be an adversary who will try to manipulate the predictions of my algorithm, I have to be careful at design time to anticipate this kind of attacks. The technology that you use to collect your sample, right? So, like, oftentimes, you know, there have been attempts to use this, you know, image recognition software for medical scans. But what has been found is that, you know, like, the exact machine that you use in collecting the data is super important in whether your algorithm will be robust. So, like, if you take your data and from some machine, train your algorithm on this data, and then use it in some other hospital with a different, you know, MRI machine, then your algorithm might not be robust. So you have to be careful at design time to anticipate this, you know, potential shift in how the data is collected. And if you can control the collection, like the way data is collected before it's input in your algorithm, that's always a good idea. So, like, if you create, you know, like, you know, combined, you know, like hardware and software, type of things, then that's always better because you can control the hardware that is used to collect the data. And finally, and you know, closer to my heart as a mathematician, as I was saying earlier, the correct use of statistics. Statistics are often abused, misused or abused, and that can have detrimental effects. When you know, I mean, okay, we all saw it in, you know, during the COVID crisis. Everybody was writing papers, you know, making predictions that were all bad. Okay. All right, so this is what I had, and in the last slide is my last reference to shipping. This is what DALL-E 2 generates when you give it as prompt, a shipping container with solar panels on top and a propeller on one end that can drive through the ocean by itself. The self-driving shipping container is driving under the Golden Gate Bridge during a beautiful sunset with dolphins jumping around it. DALL-E generates this nice image. I don't think I see any dolphins, do you? But okay, it's really interesting. Thank you very much.
Hello? Okay. So I guess this is what it looks to watch Usain Bolt run at slow motion. Thank you, Konstantino, for the talk. Now, let me please quickly share some things that we've been working on at Signal since last Posidonia. So the main development since last Posidonia, during last Posidonia, we unveiled or launched our tanker product. We thought that we were going to have a dry product soon after, but it turns out we didn't know that many things about the dry market. So it took our team a lot of work. They did an amazing job at learning how the dry market works in order to build our dry product. And also, I'm very grateful to SSY, our partner in developing this product, that helped us learn this market. We've launched our dry product 6 months ago, and since then we've had 27 client companies, and we're hoping to get to 100 companies by the end of the year that use our dry product. And hopefully by next Posidonia, you should expect us to also cover LNG, LPG, and the container ships. The second thing is that we have vastly extended the information inside the platform. Now it covers things like emissions, valuations, freight pricing, FFA prices, and the cargo types that are being carried on board the ship, and the quantities of the commodities on board the ships. And this can help you understand, let's say, more broadly the freight market when you have this additional information. And we'll also have made it a lot more flexible with what we call APIs to bring data into and out of the platform, which is kind of the modern way of making your platform play well with other computer systems and with specific requirements that the user might have. And finally, we are aggregating a lot of the information in our platform in what we call topic-centric dashboards, which allow you to basically in one dashboard get all the information you want about one topic, and I'll explain that by showing an example. So if we look at the C3 route, which is the Capes going from Brazil to China, there are a few questions that you will want to answer, and our platform in the back, in the databases, kind of deep inside the databases, and also dispersed in a few dashboards, truly has all the information you need. The thing it doesn't do for the time being is it doesn't make it that simple for you to find a way to actually retrieve the information, in like 1 minute. So when we look at C3, for example, you want to answer questions like which capes are ballasting towards South Africa and Brazil. You want to say, you want to know when they will be arriving. Are they fixed or available? You want to know how the number of ballasters is evolving over time and how is that correlated with the market rates. The market rate is the green line, and the gray line at the top chart is the number of ballasters. And the graph below is the demand for ships to load cargoes in Brazil. And if you have a bit of a graph eye, you will be able to see that there's a clear anti-correlation between the number of ships heading towards Brazil and the market rates when the supply is constant. I mean, sorry, the demand of cargo is constant. And then a freight trader that trades this route will also ask, want to know, you know, how the average speeds of ships is changing, what the C3, this particular route, forward freight agreement looks like, the forward curve, what does the iron ore futures look like, which is the main commodity transported, what is the congestion at the ports in Brazil, the congestion at the port in China, because in essence, shipping is just a big logistics chain, and basically you kind of want to know where there's traffic and how much of a prediction there is about how many ships are going to be needed on the road, and all these things together. If you put them in one dashboard, you can have basically for someone anything they want to commercially analyze the market. And the beauty with computers is that you can automate everything to the extent that, you know, it's fresh all the time. Every time you access it, you have the latest information. And our vision here is to create one such dashboard for all the important routes in shipping and all the important topics more broadly in shipping. So, you know, when you see such a dashboard, hopefully you will see a useful dashboard that can help you on your daily awareness about the market you're interested in. And also when I look at it, I see a team that has worked really hard to put all this data together so that they make it really easy for you to only spend 2 minutes on seeing, you know, what the market is doing. So this theme will continue on other topics as well on the platform. This is one we've built lately, which has to do with emissions reporting and benchmarking. You know, we all know this is going to be required of us more and more. And I'm not going to go into the details of the dashboard, but basically for your fleet, you can see all the EXI, CII, Poseidon principles, all this nice stuff that people are expecting us to compute about the CO2 emissions. And we are actually also working with General Index now, which is the up-and-coming price reporting agency, working with a lot of commodity traders to help them gain access to some of these numbers and help commodity traders also improve their supply chains with respect to CO2 emissions. So if you now can find all the data that you want in one place, you know, what else can you ask from a chartering platform? So this is my last example and last slide. When you do spot chartering, it's a little bit like playing a game of snooker where you're hitting, you know, with a white ball, the other balls, you're trying to pocket them. And depending on what you pocket, you make some points, you get some points. And with a ship, you know, every time you decide where you're going to send and who you're going to charter the ship with, you change the probabilities or where your ship will end up and how much money it will make in the future. So like in billiards, sometimes it's better to try to hit, to pocket a ball, which is harder to hit, instead of going for the obvious easy one, because then the white ball ends up in a spot that allows you to pocket a higher value ball. So in this case, I'm just showing an example from Aframax that opens in West Coast India. And from West Coast India, looking at our data, we can automatically see that 75% of the time, approximately, you're going to load out of the Arabian Gulf. And, you know, I think everyone who works in the spot market understands that quite well. But maybe the thing that people don't understand that well is that depending on the charterer that will book, you will book the ship to, you change the probability of where the ship will end up afterwards and how much money it will make after this current voyage is completed. In this case, we see that there are four possible geographical areas the ship can go to, and there's a 4% chance that the ship is going to make, in this case, $18,500 a day, which is the worst number out of all the four choices. But actually, if you do the next, let's say, voyage calculation on the fly using all the data we have, you can see that if you go in that direction, eventually you will make more money and the smart TCE, as we call it, is the highest one out of all the choices. So then, you know, if you're a chartering professional, you say, what should I do now in order to try to get this like higher value outcome out of my trading of the ship? So then again, you dig into the data, and the data will tell you that the charterers you should be calling are Chevron, Cheftex, which is the same, Glencore, and ATC. So our chartering team does this kind of work every day, trying to maximize the amount of money that the ships are making. Like a taxi driver driving through the streets and being smart about what's the next direction that they should head to. But we do it with a lot of data, and obviously the financial game is a much bigger and, let's say, more impressive in terms of numbers. So our amazing pools team does this every day, and I'll ask Panos to come and talk more about what they do. Thank you very much.
Hi, everyone. You must be hungry by now, so I'll try and be quick. Thank you, Yanni. Welcome. It's been 4 years since we communicated our vision in this same venue, and the vision was to create our first Aframax pool and changing the pooling business as we know it. We wanted to build a first Greek-based pool where it's also transparent, flexible, and fair. And of course, top performing. Our dream originated from our belief that business understanding combined with technology can actually transform the way we look at this business and making it more exciting space and change commercial pooling while respecting the structure of the market and its participants and their values, of course. During our journey, we faced lots of challenges, but our amazing team had the courage, the stamina, and the drive to overcome them. In 2018, we did launch our Aframax pool and provided continuous feedback on the Signal Ocean platform. Last year, we launched our second pool in the MR segment with support from Astra and Shell. Thank you, Ari. Thank you, Stefane. Thank you, Shell. George is here, I know. In terms of numbers, our fleet has been growing at a rate of 68% year on year, while our team consists of about 60 people as we speak, running a fleet of about 40 vessels. The ways we plan to grow further is organically, by simply trying to attract good quality pool partners, concluding strategic partnerships with an open mind, taking select exposure through time charter deals, and our newest approach to consider offering everything we have built to operate as a pool to others who might be interested. In the coming months, we might also be entering a new tanker segment, so watch that space. In terms of performance, we see here the Aframax figures since inception. Signal is the blue bar on the chart, and as you can see, we have managed to consistently outperform other pools in a highly competitive space. Our performance is, and we expect it to remain, the main driver of our growth going forward. Now, on MRs, the story is slightly different. Our beginning last year was challenging, being small in size, with difficult starting positions, while competing with large and established players, gave us a bumpy start, Q3, Q4. Nevertheless, that is exactly when our technology proved to technology and analytical thinking proved to be most valuable. Among other things that we will talk about, we were able to look at what others were doing and try to learn from them. For example, we looked at the Hafnia fleet, the Scorpio fleets, to understand their geographical deployment and voyage selection. We used data and tools and a lot of human effort to finally catch up with competition in the current quarter, as you can see. So what is it that we do at Signal Maritime with technology, and why does it make such a difference? Basically, we're trying to answer some difficult questions that simply a human does not have enough hours in the day to do so. And some examples of these questions are, What if one could have a list at any point in time of all ships on water ranked from the best to the worst based on their particulars and market conditions? This way, anyone interested to buy or time charter a vessel would be able to evaluate a specific ship compared to others. This dynamic vessel ranking list, and here actually we have a sample of the MRs, is actually available, and we use it for our time charter deals, but also for pool candidate vessels. Now, if our chosen ship from that list was to be delivered in the US Gulf versus West Coast India, what would be the monetary difference between the two locations? This is what we call position value. And for instance, these days, for Aframaxes, the difference between US Gulf and West Coast India is in the order of $400,000 in favor of the US Gulf. This number is important because it can be used to price freight options across the world, of course, and also enables our pool to not have to ask for minimum commitments from its partners. Now, let's assume we got the chosen ship from that list and it was delivered in the West Coast India. What is the best first voyage to perform given all the permutations of future voyages that will follow? Which charterer is moving our preferred cargo and how often? Now, you saw that before. This is the optimal strategy tool that Yannis briefly talked about, and it helps us identify our optimal path and, most importantly, how to get there. So, assuming we now have fixed our ship, our chosen ship from the list, to the theoretically best possible business, how did that business actually compare with all other real alternatives that took place? Was there a better cargo that for some reason we missed? Did we see all the relevant cargoes that got fixed? Was our timing correct? For that difficult exercise, we have the spot performance management tool, and we use it to go back in time and reevaluate our decision and all other cargoes that we could have done, and make sure we discuss our learnings and take specific actions to improve. All these are real examples of how technology can assist the world of chartering. Of course, it goes without saying, it is people that actually get the job done. So it is most important to have the right people on board. We're conscious that, after all, we're service providers. So our focus remains in our partner satisfaction and continuous and constructive feedback. We feel close to them through regular meetings and check-ins and video calls. We also try to simplify our reporting. It's not as easy as it sounds. As much as possible, and offer them transparency through our pool partners portal. And we will keep working hard to deliver results and improve our services, simply because we love what we're doing. And our partner satisfaction is a source of that excitement. So a wholehearted thank you to each one of the signalers here, and of course a big thank you to all of you here, and especially to our pool partners of Signal, who honor us with their continued trust. Let me now hand over to Nicolas Piriotis, our Vice President of Technology Ventures. Thank you.
Thank you, Pano, and good evening, everyone. I'm the last man standing between you and drinks and food, so I'll take it very short. In 5 minutes, we'll conclude. I will give you a perspective a little bit of what we do on the venturing side, venture investing. So already 3 years ago, the prediction of how maritime digital technology will grow was impressive. But then as COVID happened, as we had supply chain disruptions and the push for decarbonization picked up, technology adoption actually accelerated. And by the end of 2021, the value of digital tech had grew 20% higher than what we expected earlier on. So our belief is that digital technology is now here to stay to modernize our industry. We actually expect that by 2030, the value of digital tech, and that's purely digital, right? No equipment, no OEMs, will reach $350 billion. And to put that into perspective, that's the same order of magnitude as the entire asset value of all dry vessels. And in terms of growth, this will be close to 10% per year. That will make it faster than the global information and technology market growth. So, you know, what drives that growth? We think it's fueled by the resilient entrepreneurs and startups out there, and obviously the venture capital and private equity firms that have started investing more energetically in the sector. And the switch happened recently when people stopped relating the market potential of startups to the number of vessels in the commercial fleet, but instead assessing the potential with things like the value of fuel spent, the millions of seafarers on vessels, the tens of millions of containers moving around the world, and ultimately how much value is left on the table. So actually since 2020, we estimate that the total venture investing in maritime digital tech has been $3 billion, which is an impressive amount if you think about it. Venture capital funds have invested in a variety of early stage startups like Deep Sea and Seafair, which are also two companies that we have invested in. And private equity has come in and stepped in large software companies like Vesson, which also recently announced an estimated $200 million round, which actually in venture terms would make it the first maritime unicorn. And actually that makes Vesson a success story that we should all aspire to become. And recently with their acquisitions of Q88 and Ocean Bolt, they're also spearheading in the consolidation and integration in the industry, which allows them to expand their product offering, expand the customers, and ultimately shareholder value. We expect more of this M&A activity to happen, and this is an efficient way for companies to grow, but it's also a great exit opportunity for many of the founders that have been working really hard to get there. Overall, we see enough signs to be optimistic that over the next decade, we'll see a handful of companies reaching what we call unicorn status, so more than $1 billion valuation in our industry. So seeing this change taking place, in 2021, we set up our own venture capital arm, Signal Ventures, with three goals in mind. Number one, we want to put our own little contribution to the maritime industry modernization. So we come from a shipping tradition, a shipping nation, so we want to influence this change. Number two, we want to leverage an ecosystem growth. We love technology. We want to build an ecosystem of companies that leverage product and data synergies, and hence can open new customers, new opportunities in new geographies. And last but not least, we believe that we can benefit financially, obviously, from this. Otherwise, we wouldn't do it. Investing early and smart in a space that is picking up pace now. Our focus has been on early stage startups, mostly in software, data, and analytics. And we operate both as a venture capital, investing in third-party startups, but we also operate as a venture studio, which means we develop our own software that we will then spin off as separate entities. So what have we done so far? We have invested in 11 ventures across 7 countries, covering key maritime verticals. And we're excited about the early signs that we see in our portfolio. Already 3 out of our 11 companies have gone to raise additional capital by external funds at a valuation on average 5 times higher than when we initially invested. And to an extent, key to the success has been synergies that we identified early on. And the best example in this is OilX, which is a company that was launched through our venture studio and was built on top of Signal Ocean's voyage data. Along the way, we also provided functional support like recruiting, legal, finance, that allowed the team to focus 100% on their product. Shiplex just launched their new era voyage management system, and by also relying on several of our APIs, have brought forward their time to market by at least a year. So overall, this is a space that we're very excited about and what lies ahead. So, if you're interested in co-investing or have ideas about new ventures, please get in touch with us. In the meantime, please visit the Signal Ventures kiosk, which is right outside this hall, to talk to the founders of the companies in our ecosystem. Thank you very much for listening, and I'll pass it back to Dimitris for last remarks.
So, thank you so very much for your attention and your patience. We're literally done. Before we ask you to transition from food for thought to thought of food and cold refreshments. Ours don't come with a dollar sign, by the way. Please allow us to extend a huge, huge thank you to our team, who have made all this possible, basically, through hard work, determination, and perhaps a bit of overuse of pajama bottoms under the table. Thank you, Professor Daskalakis, for being with us and inspiring, you know, the whole of Greece with your scientific endeavors. And thank you to our clients and our partners, without whom, well, this will be kind of pointless. So thank you, and see you out there.